We are now in my neck of the woods. Whoa, he's learned!
A doctoral dissertation on what? Japanese hip hop? I'm sorry, I didn't know that was a thing.
Piccolo's the black guy of Dragon Ball.
Piccolo was just that guy. Woo, you working me.
You know, we're just having a conversation here.
Right, yeah, just casual conversation while I'm getting split in half. It's cool.
Oh, that was sick.
Ladies and fellas, men, welcome to this episode of Otaku Talk. I'm joined by Black Crystal and a very special guest, Dr. Dexter Thomas Jr., who is the host of Vice's video game docuseries, Reset, and also a big anime fan. Am I reading that right?
Yeah, you mean that right? Yeah.
Okay.
Can't say I'm as knowledgeable as some, but definitely a fan. I'm happy to be here.
Doctor? I'm sorry? A doctoral dissertation on what? You gotta let me know. You gotta let me know.
Got some esteem over there.
Japanese hip hop? I'm sorry. I didn't know that was a thing. How were you able to become a doctor in inside subjects?
Oh, man. How was I able to do that? You'd have to ask my advisors.
They're the ones
that set me loose. But the short version, I was a DJ, college radio DJ at my old school, UC Riverside. Got real interested in rap music. I was also trying to study Japanese at the time. Somehow I just kind of put the two interests together, right? And a lot of applications later, I finally got myself a scholarship to go to Japan, live there. Lived there for 2 years on one stint, then came back another for a third. And
oh, I'm so envious.
That is
so
cool.
It was fun. Lived there for a while, and really what I was focusing on is, what are people talking about in the lyrics? And, you know, how do they see themselves reflected in it and all that sort of thing? So that's what I did.
I'm sure this all winds back to, like, the origin story. Like, we all have that origin story. Like, was it anime that it was just kind of like a rabbit hole from there? Or how did that, like, get started for you? Where did that interest come from initially?
What did it for me was a kid on the school bus, man. This kid on the school bus had this piece of paper with a bunch of scribbles on it. And I was just, yo, what's that? And he said, oh, it's the Japanese alphabet. He called it the alphabet, right? And he's kind of, I was, oh, how does it work? And he's sort of explaining it to me. You know, I'm in high school at this point. And I'm just, that looks easy.
Yeah.
And made me a photocopy and I made myself some flashcards and legit, that was it. That was
wow.
it. I wasn't really watching anime like that. It wasn't really like that. Not
you make
then.
Me relive my college years. Like I studied, I didn't get to stay over there as long as you do, 2 years, but I did it abroad a bit. So I love for the culture and the language as you. So it's dope to hear someone say that.
For me and for a lot of people that I know, our introduction to like the Japanese culture was through anime or manga. So to hear that it wasn't the case for you and then like you picked it up later, like when did you start picking up anime?
There was a point, right? And really this, not to get too deep into it, but this I feel like Toonami was one of those breaking points, right?
Yeah.
Because if you think about before it, anime, a lot of Japanese culture, a lot of Japanese pop culture used to kind of hide itself, particularly when it came to the States, right?
Yep.
And so you had kids growing up on, what is it, Power Rangers, having no idea that that was actually Japanese. No idea.
Yeah.
And there's still people you tell them that to this day, and they're just, wait, it's from what?
Yeah.
Like all the action sequences are Japanese, and they just got some American teenagers to do it.
Yeah.
So I had no idea that some of the stuff I actually liked was Japanese. I was playing more video games than I care to admit at the time.
Yeah.
And it didn't really occur to me that Nintendo was Japanese.
Yeah.
If you really asked me, maybe I would have known. You know, again, my entry point was linguistically.
Mm-hmm.
I just thought, oh, this is a cool code language that nobody else taught. Because there was no Japanese kids in my school, right?
Right.
And I think I just said, okay, well, what else is out there? Oh, there's this stuff on TV that I watch anyway. And actually, there's an original. Let me try to understand that. Oh, this game that I already played anyway, let me try to play the original. That's how it works.
I gotta switch it up a little bit. I need to present the challenge. Dexter v. Siriax, who is going to be the best DBZ fighter with limitations?
Limitations.
Limitations. We ain't gonna let you pop off like that. You think this is a game?
All right, and we're jumping right into battle with Dex, the professor, but I have to give myself a little bit of a handicap because, I mean, let's be real. We can't flex all the ball we're at once. So I'll tell you what, Dex. You can take out my first two characters, and I will only fight with the legendary assassin Hit at the end, okay?
All right. This seems fair. You are the professor here.
All right. So go ahead. Do your worst. Let's see what you got. Okay. Into Dragon Rush. Ooh, okay. Trying to put a little combo together.
very basic.
And what we could do while you're taking out my first couple characters, yeah. I could give you a couple pointers along
yes,
the
please.
Way.
Yes, please. Hey, look, you're the professor, man. Just give me some pointers here.
Do you know how to use like super attacks and ultimate attacks and stuff? So just down back and then R2 or right trigger. So down back, R2 okay. or right trigger. There you go.
Okay, got it. All right. Reverse Hadouken.
That
all
would
right.
be an ultimate. So that cost 3 bars of meter. So that one under your name there, that's your meter.
Okay.
And you just used it by vanishing.
Right,
so you
yeah.
can charge up with that. And then now you have 4, so you can do that ultimate again. There you go.
Okay, so you're teaching. Okay.
Yeah. But now Hit's here, so Hit doesn't teach. Hit shows up, and he just, I don't know if you're hip on Dragon Ball Super, but he just shows up,
game,
and he assassinates.
Game over.
Right? Oh, he's pressing buttons. All right, can I win? Can I get this comeback?
Okay, all right, here it goes. You're not even anywhere near me. How you hit me like that?
I'm the assassin. I stop time, bro. And what's crazy about these games is I don't know if you're big on like the scene of Dragon Ball FighterZ, but like it's really big in, I don't know how big it is actually in Japan, but like when it comes to tournaments and stuff, like you have your English players and you have your Japanese players, and like there's almost like a little rivalry between them when you watch like these competitive games like Evo and tournaments like that. Like you're aware of Sonic Fox, right?
Oh my gosh, yeah, the legend. Yes.
He goes crazy when it comes to like, have you seen him versus Goichi?
I've seen some of the legendary matches, yeah. Okay.
Ooh, you blocking? But I got the mix.
See, I appreciate
this. We're having a great time.
Part of teaching is, you know, letting your students know where the limits are. I appreciate this,
right,
man.
Right,
you know,
right,
this is what
exactly.
you gotta do in the classroom sometimes. I respect this.
Whoa! Oh, dang, I just had to, you know, give you a stiff one to the noggin there. You know, nothing personal there.
Corporal punishment is not usually allowed in the classroom, but yeah.
Hit said it himself. I avoided your vitals, but you won't be waking up anytime soon.
Things that you play or that you experience when it comes to media or entertainment, you don't really realize that it's Japanese. Like Dragon Ball Z is a prime example of a show that I watched when I was a kid, and I had no idea what anime was. I didn't know that it was right. based, you know, Japanese based or anything. That's what kind of got me down the rabbit hole of anime and then Japanese culture, because, you know, you experience like, you know, we can touch on music, like the introductions, like even though it's an English show, the intro will be in Japanese. And then it's just like, okay, yeah, that should be a giveaway. And then like, I don't know what they're saying, but like, I'm always bobbing my head. I'm just like, man, these guys are going crazy. Were you surprised by anything that you found when you started looking into that musically?
So first thing is I get there, and what I started doing legit, because I get there, you know, I'm in my early 20s and I'm trying to figure out, okay, I have an entire history to catch up on. I don't even know right. how far it goes back.
Right.
And so one thing that you can do in Japan is you can rent music.
Rent music?
Yes, you can rent CDs.
Yes.
This is a shop you could go to. It's kind of like a Blockbuster, you know, RIP.
Yeah, and, Hollywood Video Block, yeah.
Exactly, yeah. And so I went in, and no joke, I started from the left and I just started working my way over.
Wow.
That's
and
that, awesome.
And that just was like
it.
Everything?
And I was just, everything I could get. Okay, I'm not encouraging this. I'm just telling you that this is a phenomenon. Is they would have the CDs there, and they would sell CDRs at the front desk. They knew exactly what you were gonna do with that.
Yeah,
they didn't encourage
yeah.
it,
yeah.
but they knew what you were gonna do with it.
Yeah,
and
yeah,
I
yeah.
will say that I might know somebody who availed themselves of that ability.
Uh-huh.
Right? There was that, photocopying the lyric booklets, all that sort of thing.
Yes.
I'm going through the CD shelves, and I'm just trying to find something that I can attach myself to, right?
Right.
And
right.
eventually I start finding it. I start finding just legit classics, right? And you know, I'm talking Buddha Brand. I'm talking, you know, maybe King Ghidra, right, for a while. And I'm finding like weird underground stuff that even a whole lot of Japanese people don't listen to. But there was one record or a single by this group called Buddha Brand. And there's a track called Ningen Hatsudensho. So it's something like human electricity generator or something like
yeah.
that. And weirdly, if you know the whole city pop thing, how that got really popular, this particular song, so what's her name? Maria Takeuchi, I think.
Okay.
Plastic Love, right?
Okay.
If you know Plastic
okay,
Love,
yeah,
if you've
yeah.
seen that, how that got real big, Japanese hip hop had this weird little kind of mini moment like that where a bunch of Americans found that song, but like more than 10 years ago, I found this track and I was just, oh my God, what is this? Because it
yeah.
legit, it felt like a coast that I've forgotten about, right? Because I'm from the West Coast. I listen to a bunch of East Coast music.
Oh,
it felt
yeah.
like, oh
it's
my
like
God.
It's like another dimension.
Yeah. And it was, I had this whole other, you know, this whole other just history that I had to catch up on. And a lot of it really felt like New York, because Buddha Brand was this group that had spent a bunch of time in New York, formed in New York, and then gone back to Japan and started doing their thing in Japanese.
Yeah.
And weirdly enough, a couple of those dudes, or at least one of them, ended up, and you know, I'm watching anime at the same time, right? And I end up watching this anime called Tokyo Tribe.
Okay.
And which is basically heavily, it's all hip hop influence. It's nothing but hip hop, right?
Right.
And it turns out that one of the rappers in this group, Buddha Brand, is prominently featured in this anime.
Yeah.
In the opening sequence.
Yeah.
And just everything starts to come together for me.
I think a lot of anime, you know, the same way like Dragon Ball was the segue for me into anime, and then I get into anime, and then the intros and like the title sequences, those are my introduction into like this new genre or this new type of music, you know, Japanese music. For me, it was more because like the Naruto openings and stuff like that, it's more J-rock, so Japanese rock and stuff like that. So I get hip on bands like 1OK Rock, you know, back on, and then when it comes to Dragon Ball, you have bands like Flo and stuff like that. And then when it comes to hip hop, I watch this anime called Gurren Lagann that huge fan of, huge Kamina fan, and they have a lot of hip hop throughout their title sequences, and then through like the little transitional mid episode cutaways and stuff like that. It's just really cool because you hear it and it sonically it sounds really cool, and you're just like, you know, it takes me back to an anime because that's where I was exposed to this.
Right.
But then again, just to know that, or just, I never thought about looking deeper into it to really see what the context of what they're saying and what they're actually saying is.
See, I'm like the opposite of that. I got very obsessive with my intros. Like I was like, if I'm gonna know any Japanese, I'm gonna know the songs that I know and the opening versions of the animes I have.
Yeah.
So like with Siri X, you mentioned J-Rock, I was like, yes, Maximum the Hormone, Nightmare, I'm loving it. But then the thing that changed me, and when I, like, I don't know, I think everybody felt this way, is you see Samurai Champloo and you discover New Jabez, and you're literally in a realm where you never knew it could exist because it made sense. You're watching a historical period anime, but with these very contemporary, still yet old school hip hop vibes, it took me into a real realm. So I have to ask, Duster, since we have you and this is your thing, what in the hell is that? Is New Jabez, and how do you feel about it? Because that is, that is it for me when it comes to Japanese and hip hop. Even though,
so this is the thing that trips a lot of people out when I tell them this. So, I was introduced maybe a different way. I was introduced to Samurai Champloo by somebody telling me, "Yo, Dex, you gotta watch this anime." And I'm just kind of how often do you get told this? I'm gonna watch
all
this anime.
The time,
And then my guy Brian sent me the soundtrack, and I was just, all right, I'll watch this. I'm gonna watch this, right?
That's
so
dope.
So I go to Japan, right, thinking that, oh, New Jabez is just that dude.
Right.
Everybody must be listening to people. And so I can't speak, obviously, I cannot speak for every hip-hop listener. I can't speak for every Japanese person because, obviously. But nobody I knew liked New Jabez.
Oh my God.
Nobody. And so this is before he passed, right?
Right.
Yeah.
And so a lot of people thought of him as like Starbucks music. It's like, this is what plays when you're going to the Starbucks. Yo, and I'm dead serious, because the thing is, there had been a period where people were just really, especially Tokyo, was into this really hard, a lot of people weren't really into samples.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
People were just in really just hard stuff, hard drums, you know, hard synthesizers, you know, production-wise. New Jabez wasn't like that. That just wasn't his thing. And New Jabez was also very particular about his stuff, because he used to own a record store. And it was something like when Jay-Z would come out with a record and he wouldn't really stock it because he was just, I don't really like it. It's just, what are you doing not stocking Jay-Z? But it was because he was very particular about his music, where he was even apparently a little bit hesitant about having his music in an anime because he didn't want to be an anime composer. He didn't want to
write.
He had a very particular way of, this is what my hip hop is.
Yeah.
And it was actually very separate from what Japanese hip hop was doing at the time.
Yeah.
And so when he passed, and then when a lot of Japanese people realized that, oh, there's all these foreigners who are super into New Jabez, I think, And this is, again, this is like the crew that I was hanging around with.
Yeah, I hung around
with a lot of rappers, a lot of people in the hip hop scene.
Okay.
And they were just, I think I was the only person who really liked New Jabez. Most people were just kind of, he's all right. But yeah, okay, right. I can see how you Americans like him.
All right, so same thing. Go ahead and wear me down. Use some of the stuff that you've learned.
Okay.
What's cool about Dragon Ball FighterZ that makes it a little more accessible early on, it has auto combo. So literally, if you just press the square button or X if you're using an Xbox controller, just keep pressing it and you will do a whole combo into a knockdown. This is just like a cool way to, you know, learn the game before you know all the combos, because this was actually my first fighting game.
Really?
So it definitely got me hit to like other fighting games, and of course Dragon Ball would be my segue into like other fighting games.
Oh, yeah. That's surprising. I wouldn't have thought that.
All right, I noticed you have Piccolo on your team. I heard that. Is Piccolo your favorite? That's your go-to guy?
Piccolo's part of the culture, man. That's, you know, one of the more positive black father figures that we have.
Piccolo's the black guy of Dragon Ball, but we can't really put our finger on why. Is it because there's no other black representation, so we just gotta be like, it's Piccolo? Or what do you think that is?
I mean, it's super deep. I think it's, you know, you look at Skeeter and Doug, right? Skeeter's not black, but he's black. You know what I mean?
And
I think it's just one of those things where we're used to finding a character and deciding this is our guy, and I think Piccolo was just that guy. Woo, you working me?
Yeah. I thought, you know, we're just having a conversation here.
Right, yeah, just casual conversation while I'm getting split in half. It's cool. I mean, the thing about Piccolo is, if you watch the Japanese version, there's no indication this guy is supposed to be black. He's legit not black, but we just decided
he's Namekian. Yeah, he's an alien.
Exactly. If you ask Japanese people this, you say, oh yeah, Piccolo's black, right? They'll say, wait, what?
Right, they're like, no, he's not. He's Namekian.
Yeah, he's a green guy.
If we don't exist in this platform, like, damn it, we'll make ourselves exist.
You'll find yourself. We will find ourselves. And that's, I think everybody does that.
Look, I'm on the side. This is a very hot topic, very big debate when it comes to the anime community. But manga versus anime, like, you don't have any of that musical sort of aesthetic when it comes to a manga. And I'm not downing manga by any means, but I'm just on the side of anime because, like, it's so much more stimulating. Yeah, it's much more of an experience. Like, imagine, I'm not saying, again, I know the manga readers are looking at me like I'm crazy. I know. And I will accept my fate. But nevertheless, Attack on Titan's OST, like, just musically is one of the most amazing things I've ever heard in my life, like, composed, period. Like, outside of the anime medium, just period. You don't get that when you read a manga. So what is your stance on the manga anime debate? Do you have both? Do you need to experience both? Or how are you guys feeling when it comes to that?
I'm with you. I think it's a big experience. So I'm with you on that, on the anime side. I think there is something that the holistic thing of seeing the animation, hearing the sounds, the voice acting, all of it really bringing it together is super important. And sometimes some of the soundtracks are like the most memorable things from the work. A lot of the times I want to get behind the scene. So I'm curious if Dexter, you do have answers to this. I don't know why I assume you're an industry expert of anime music production. Mama put you on the spot. I want to know, like, for Samurai Champloo, it feels like they were like, here's the soundtrack, and then they did the anime. Like, I'm convinced, like, sometimes the tracks are almost feel like they were drawn to the music rather than the music being placed into the anime. And I've always found it fascinating, like, who orchestral military music on Attack on Titan, and it's a banger. How did we get there? And I really think it's something to the unique to the black experience. I don't know, maybe it's the hip-hop community, but the flavor that is added to some of the most saddest songs I've heard as outros to the most litest orchestral openings, like from One Punch Man, you want to get out your seat. Like, they know how to convey that emotion, and I don't know if I can find that anywhere else.
I mean, I think you could definitely say, for something like Samurai Champloo, I mean, hip hop was definitely in the imagination while it was being made. You know,
while
there's
it was
no
in the manga form
that.
As well.
Yeah, it was. You could feel it. And I mean, you know, there's other things like, I'll go back to Tokyo Tribe, right? And I do have to say, listen, if you watch Tokyo Tribe, there are some extremely disturbing scenes, particularly in the first episode, so that is something to be aware of. But Tokyo Tribe, so think about Tokyo Tribe, is this was this real kind of underground manga that it was kind of one of those things where if you know it, you know it. But this guy was writing about his favorite hip-hop groups, and so his characters would go hang out somewhere and say, oh, did you get the new Redman? Yeah, I got the new Redman. Man, did you hear it? And so there's definitely artists where even in the manga, they're sitting there and they're actually educating you about, here's what records are hot in the US. Here's who you should listen to. They're going back and talking about like New Jack Swing, stuff that nobody's listening to at this point.
But I was going to say, it's like a time capsule. Like when you read that manga, it takes you back to like, it tells you what era you're in based off of like what they're talking about musically and stuff like that. That's really cool.
Definitely.
Yeah. Speaking of the difference between anime and manga, did you notice any sort of difference in terms of their perspective of like this medium as a whole? So anime or manga, like we see it as like this hip sort of pop cultural thing that's in our society, like it's engraved into our society now. But like, is there any sort of difference with how they view it versus how we view it over here?
I would almost compare it to hip hop, honestly, which is to say that if you live in the United States, hip hop is just in the atmosphere. Mm-hmm. You can't go outside. You can't get into an Uber or something like that.
Yeah, it's just there.
Without somebody probably, and that's to say nothing about, you know, the driver sees that you're black and then turns to the hip hop station. We'll leave that alone, right? But in Japan, anime is just, it's just all around.
Right.
You know what I mean? Right. And so there are definitely people who are just, oh, you listen to anime, you watch anime?
Yeah.
Oh, they're kind of a nerd, right? And so you, Japanese people get that.
Yeah, 100%, okay.
Right?
Okay.
But then also it's just sort of, it's all around. And so I think a lot of Americans will go to Japan and they'll say, oh my God, it's the land of anime. I can talk to everybody about anime. And like, they'll know Pokemon.
Yeah.
But then you start trying to talk to them about real deep stuff and it's just, whoa, I've never seen that. I'm just Japanese. I'm not an expert.
Alright, ladies and fellas, man, that's gonna do it for us. Thank you so much for watching this episode of Otaku Talk, and be sure to check out the full version over on the Gaming While Black channel, and follow us on Instagram and Twitter for so much more content in the future. I'll see you over there.